Okay, it's 7 o'clock. This is the meeting of the Conway Board of Selectmen for March 21st. First item on our agenda, minutes for the March 14 meeting. Did everybody have a chance to review the minutes? Any corrections or additions?
I didn't see anything.
No? Okay. I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes for March 14th.
Second.
Do I have a second? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Next item on the agenda, we have warrants. We have three warrants. We have a vendor warrant for $407,659. A payroll warrant for $96,393. And a payroll deduction warrant for $25,391. I'll make a motion that we approve those warrants.
Second.
Do I have a second? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
And just a note, if anyone's watching, the $400,000 vendor warrant included payments to both Frontier and Conway
yes.
Grammar School.
Operating.
There were a couple other large, there's a health insurance payment on there, and the dump body truck bill came in,
right.
We're paying. So
yeah.
that's a lot of that.
Yeah. All came in at once. Okay. Meetings attended by select board members. Do we have any meetings in the last week?
I went to the cabin raising that Will Elwell built. That's right in the middle of where the pipeline's supposed to go.
Up in Ashfield.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I went to the documentary movie on Thursday night in Ashfield.
Oh, okay.
It wasn't a real meeting. Yeah. The pipeline takes a lot of time, it seems, these days.
Yeah, spending a lot of time in Ashfield these days.
Yeah, it seems like it.
All right. Thanks, Jim. Any citizens' concerns? No, I don't see any. Okay. All right, next item is the town meeting warrant. Items so far. Tom?
Right. Just some updates. The Finance Committee is meeting right now upstairs, mm-hmm. and they're hoping to finish their recommendations on Article 2 tonight and
okay.
start on the money item. I've invited Dana Goodfield in for the final recommendations next week. They're meeting Thursday night,
okay.
and so I've suggested he come in and give us final recommendations from the committee. Just a few items. You actually don't see it here in Article 2, but I had a long conversation with Joe Colucci, our animal control officer.
Right.
And I think it's important to budget for the work that actually gets done in case some of the people who take on personal expenses themselves can no longer do the job. We need to actually know how much it costs to do that. So based on that, internally, I've shifted $300 from his training line item to his salary line item, because the training's free, and he gets that, but there's time out of his day that he spends doing that. Now, that said, that's still not the hours that he actually works, so I've asked him to keep as close tabs on that as possible, so we know exactly how much time the animal control officer actually
is working. 292 account, 292.
Yeah.
Okay.
I just thought I'd mention that. The audit is, that's 135, is back to $13,000. We did get a reserve fund transfer approved by the Finance Committee to pay for the end-of-year audit that the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education requires of us every 3 years,
mm-hmm. yeah.
which was kind of a surprise to me this year. Town administrator line item is down to 88,763. It's down 2,000. This was after some money that was in there for the web-based finance system got shifted to a separate article to see
right.
whether or not the townspeople want a web platform to look at the town's budget. Frontier Transportation is down. They actually have a cost of living agreement, and the way that they calculated it actually went down. So we're saving money on Frontier Transportation. We're also saving money on Conway Transportation quite a bit. For all of
That's refreshing.
Yeah.
For so all
the
of the...
The bus around half empty?
There was a lot of anxiety. I at least had a lot of anxiety about the estimates of the Frontier and the Conway budgets. And if you iron it all out, I was off by about $2,000. It's about $2,000 more, unfortunately, than I estimated, but that's not as bad as I was thinking at one point. I still will have to estimate 193, the insurance line. I don't think we're going to have a hard figure for that. General liability is going to go up 3.5%. And we also have to add on the extra amount, about another $1,000, for the revalued buildings that we paid out of the reserve fund this year. I'll have to add that in for next year. Workers' comp will be going up on the order of 10%. And that's a substantial item. So we're looking at a fair increase in that line item, probably more than the $4,500 that's there now.
Yeah.
That is it for Article 2. We should talk tonight. Just a word on the timing. If we can make recommendations on any of these items tonight, I think that would be good. Next week we should finalize the warrant, if at all possible, with the Finance Committee. It'll be probably a long meeting, and we'll go through absolutely everything. But if anything can be done tonight, that would be great, as far as I'm concerned.
Well, we're going to have a joint meeting with Finance next week.
Yes.
All right, so we can run through these and make our recommendations next week.
Okay. All right.
Just
so long as we know what the timing is.
Yeah.
We're a little bit behind, but I did build in a little
extra time
for us to be behind. So
I think we did.
So that's good. The things that we need to pay particular attention to: Article 7, the $30,000 request from the 250th Anniversary Committee.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I am withdrawing my proposal for Article 12. I think the thing for me to do is to get together with some other employees, and maybe Dana, and come up with a good argument for the need for more space. Have that be a public process with, you know, fair amount of publicity, so people get used to the idea, and that will not an official committee, just more or less
more awareness. Nothing else.
Convene a task force, and we'll try to come up with some facts and figures to be able to use as we go through this process. I hope next year.
Do you know Peter Jeswald?
Yes. Yes.
Ask Peter to come in.
Yeah, and I have his drawings, his preliminary drawings, and I've actually tweaked them myself. And he could be a good one for coming up with how much things should cost as well.
Sure.
At this point, I'm still leaving this item on, Article 13, to see whether people want the financial transparency of a web-based product. Someone is set to come out to give a presentation on May 9th.
On the actual date of the...
At town meeting.
Really?
Yeah. So they'll show people what it is.
I need 10 minutes, too.
Oh, no. You're down 3, too.
I'm down 3.
And, you know, people may have questions and that sort of thing. I'm sure they do a lot of this sort of thing, so I'm sure they know the limitations. I do not yet have money for community preservation, but...
When are you expecting?
Look forward to getting that very quickly. I'll have it by the next meeting.
Okay.
Certainly. Because I want it to be done. And we'll need to know what that figure is. Of course, it's it won't have that much effect on the tax rate because it's a 3% surcharge. So, and the amount doesn't vary that much from year to year.
Right.
So it's not a raise and appropriate in that sense. For Article 19, we're going to hear from Joe. Actually, we're not going to hear from Joe on Article 19. We're going to hear from Joe on Article 20. Article 19 came in with a request for $50,000 for testing private wells and air quality for occupied residences potentially impacted by the proposed NED pipeline route through Conway.
What's the envelope there? Is it 1,000 feet from the pipeline?
That's what's in our bylaw. I don't know what they discussed.
Well, wasn't it in the bylaw that the pipeline had to pay for
that?
Yes. Why are we appropriating money here?
Talk to the Board of Health about that.
Yeah, this did come in as a recommendation from the Board of Health.
What I understood is that we were going to say, as part of this understanding,
we did pass it in bylaw. If the AG accepted it.
Yeah.
And then if FERC accepts it.
We put it into our paperwork for submission to DPU, didn't we?
My understanding.
Yeah, but
if FERC denies it, and the AG denies it, then.
Yeah.
This would be the conditions that FERC puts on the permit that they give
in right.
Yeah. So, and I've asked Peggy at the call for clarification as to the timing and form that request should take. I do not believe Article 20. We're going to have an Article 22 here, right to farm.
Which one do you think?
We don't have anything.
Okay.
So that's not going to happen, and that's the end of my notes. So we can go to the other specific things on the agenda.
Okay.
On that.
Thank you, Tom. All right. Next item on the agenda is
This is where we would cover. Yeah. I'm sorry. Yes. Same
item.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry.
Joe, you're up.
Is it me?
It's you, Joe.
It's me, okay. Hopefully I staple those together in the right order. The first one is the change to unregistered motor vehicles. This is some of the fallout from our attempt to change the bylaws at town meeting a year or so ago. We've had a number of complaints about the number of cars surrounding our used car dealerships. One of the major complaints that we had.
Yep.
Actually, Tom helped us out. He surveyed some of the surrounding towns and found that most of them have a requirement that the applicant for a license has to get a special permit before he can get a used car license. And the process then is you go through and you talk to the abutters, and the planning board decides how many cars you can keep on the premise. And these are based on space or whatever criteria they use. They say, okay, on that space, you can keep 10 cars, and they can be all junk cars, or they can be all saleable cars, or some combination thereof, is typically what other towns do. So we wrote that in. So the one you have is for our protected bylaws. We just changed the first sentence to make sure it says, of any kind on any premises, so that it's clear that everyone is governed by this law. And then everything else is an exception, which we really didn't change much from what was in the original bylaw. We added at the bottom a section saying that applicants seeking to be licensed by the select board intending to keep more than one unregistered motor vehicle on premises not in an enclosed building must obtain a special permit. So if you want to leave cars outside for sale, go to the planning board, get a special permit. And then it's clear, and these would have a time limit on them and an ownership limit. So if the building got sold or the property got transferred, you would have to get a new one. So the license would then say you're allowed to keep 10 cars, let's say. So if you get to 11, you're in violation of the bylaw. right now it's kind of a difficult bylaw to enforce because there's nothing in their permit that says how many cars, for instance, at Langevin, that they can keep, you know.
Mm-hmm. When this new, if this gets enacted, Joe, on this 32.5-4, it says, nor shall any article apply to landowners or tenants who store motor vehicles out of sight of abutters or public ways. So that means anybody can have a junkyard in the back door here?
Yeah, that's out of sight? That's the original bylaw. We didn't change that. I mean, if someone wants to make a motion to change it, that's currently the way it is. It says, if it's visible from the road or from your neighbors, you either have to put it in a building or put it behind a fence. Mm-hmm. Basically, the way it's written. We have a few of those.
Didn't
in town.
We used to have license for junkyards in town? I remember back when Jesse Upright used to have a junkyard. We may have even had a license.
A
he even had it posted on the. On his
bylaw says
was
you
this
can't.
Out of his house?
Yeah, it was out of his house. It was up out of sight.
Was it legal?
He had to get a special permit from town of Conway and do it and get a special license for it.
I didn't know he had a junk yard up there.
He had 1,500 cars up there.
I guess we didn't change that from the original. That's that wording, other than taking out the word the, I guess, in that sentence. That's the existing bylaw. That's our current bylaw. That whole thing, except for the word "the," that's the only thing we changed. And the ones with no strikeouts are the way they are currently.
There's no other requirement in the law anyway to specialize that, right?
Well, our other bylaw, there is a set of prohibited uses in Conway, and it says you're not supposed to have a junk or salvage yard. So I don't know.
So wouldn't this, just putting this back into this article, wouldn't that kind of let people see it in two different places? Where, yeah, we can't have one. One says, no, you can't. The other one says, you can.
A junkyard is a commercial operation.
Right. And that's why I'm confused with whether, when you said he had to get a license, it's a class 3 license as a junkyard. And there are state laws about how junkyards. If you're talking a real junk salvage yard, there are state laws about how those operate.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
And our bylaw says you can't have any in Conway.
But this doesn't say that.
Well, this is talking about.
Makes it sound like you can.
This is talking about an unregistered car. That's
what junks are, unregistered.
Well, it's not necessarily a commercial operation. Mm-hmm. I think is what.
Yeah.
So junking of cars and salvaging of cars is prohibited. Right. This, I think, is restricted to unregistered cars. So if you want to have two unregistered cars,
or 22,
you got to put them in a building or put them out of sight of your abutters and the road, the highway. Public roads, and that's what that section said. It doesn't address the idea of salvaging these cars.
Right.
If you want
to keep that many on your property.
If you look at what Ray had up to his house on Riley Road, technically that should have been fenced in. You know? Mm-hmm. At one point there, he had 40 or 50 cars up there. They've grown in. The last time I was there, you can hardly see them because the trees are growing up.
They're growing up through the cars,
so now he's probably legal. But no, this is not. This section does not address junking of cars, which I think is what you're referring to. Mm-hmm. The only junk license I know of that we have in town is Bites. They have a class 3 license. Yeah. But it's only to take apart antique cars and put them back together.
Yeah. Right.
That was what he got the license for.
Yeah.
Then the next one is unregistered motor vehicles in the general bylaw. And for some reason, the whole bylaw was duplicated, except for section 1, which is now section 1. So I eliminated all the duplication, and in section 1, it says, whoever violates this bylaw in the planning board is subject to a $5 fine. That was already in there. And then we added section 2, which says, if you're trying to get a license, you must get a special grant permit first. So we tried to coordinate the general bylaw with the protective zoning bylaw.
Right.
Any questions on particular question on those?
And this is voted in. It'll take effect on the next renewal for anybody's license or any.
No, it would. Well, the way we wrote it, it would be the new applicants or transfers of ownership.
Right.
So when somebody sells a business, or if a new business comes into town, they would have to do the special permit.
No,
so it's not they're really grandfathered. So
yeah,
the right. Would
exactly.
Be grandfathered
until
they sold the business. The next one is a solar bylaw that came from the Energy Committee. They would like to add the two parcels behind the school, basically the parcel that we bought originally for the highway garage. So it's that, it's the corner, it's to the right of the highway building and behind the school. There's
You said two parcels?
Yeah, there's the original parcel, which was to protect the well, and then we bought the rest of it. So it ends up on our town map, it's still two parcels. There's a...
Will that affect, if you, in parcel one, then, will that affect if you eventually put a higher garage in it? Have any issues of that nature?
I don't know how big a solar farm they want to put in there. I guess it's probably going to end up whoever gets there first. I mean, this is putting it into the green community. Mm-hmm. But
yeah,
if they put the highway garage there, then...
Is it parcel one where the highway garage was going to go?
It's the original parcel, yes.
It's
which
my
was eventually, they said they weren't going to put it there. There were reasons why they weren't going to put it there.
It's my understanding that the solar people are primarily thinking of the other site, the one where the highway department is.
Well, what do you call parcel one? Directly behind the grammar school?
Behind the fence. If you go behind both stone walls, yeah. Both parcels are behind, that's behind the stone walls.
That's one down by Mary McClintock's.
Yeah.
Okay, and parcel two is where the...
Well, there's two in there. There's two parcels in there. We originally...
Okay, yeah,
Mrs. Boyden originally...
The stone wall and words.
Mrs. Boyden originally gave us the little parcel
right
in the corner, and then we bought the rest behind it. So
that neither one of them would affect the highway garage as to where they wanted to put this last time.
Not the last time.
Okay. Yeah, and it's certainly not their intention to do that.
The only thing I heard is that there's a trail committee that's been reactivated, and they're planning to put trails in there.
Yes, we gave permission.
Yeah. So I don't know if the trails and the solar panels are compatible. I don't know if they recommend people walking between solar panels.
We gave them permission. They're already starting working on it.
So yeah, and I think the Energy Committee is aware of it. They seem to know about the trail.
Yes.
Yeah, that shouldn't interfere.
They are.
I can't imagine anybody wanting to walk between solar panels, but if that's your thing.
They're going out into that lower field a little bit.
And there is also an easement on parcel two.
Yeah, they did.
For access for Gary Leszewski to get back his property.
I mentioned that.
So I did talk with the energy people. I said, you know, there's an easement on there, so you have to leave a roadway for Gary to get to his property. His plan someday, I think, was to build a house up there.
Yeah, it's probably never going to happen.
I don't know if it'll happen. Yeah.
But we did grant him that. Yep. Okay.
And then the last thing I was going to talk about is the, I think, it's $5,000, is it, Tom, that you put in?
Yeah.
I had left it blank, but Tom...
Came in with a $5,000 suggestion.
From the town of Montague suggested $5,000. I had left it blank. Montague was an intervener in the Berkshire Gas precedence agreement, I think it's called, where they want to be able to buy gas from Tennessee Gas, which is a NED project there, the pipeline. Mm-hmm. And they were granted intervener status. I think they were one of the few people that actually got to be an intervener because there's a lot of gas in their town, I guess, probably for the paper mills. So they have been, they hired, can you help me with the
name? Madoff? Yeah. What's that guy's name?
Kantoff? No. Richard Kantoff.
Kantoff.
Who's with Mass Plan, I think. He's their lawyer as well. And he's working with them on the intervention. I believe, and I think it's in this letter, it's not clear who will get to see the data. I think it's just a lawyer and possibly one other person. So by intervening, they will get to see the real data that Berkshire Gas has presented as to why they need this capacity. And this would also get at the gas moratorium, I guess. I'm hoping that if nothing else, we'll get at the truth. I think the pipeline opponents are hoping that there's a conspiracy going on and they can uncover it. But Ariel had contacted me and asked if the town would use the money we voted at last town meeting. And we talked with the FERCOG accountant, and she thought it was not appropriate, I think. And then Meg Burke said that, and I don't remember this, but she said at town meeting, she said that the money would only be used by the town of Conway, so I think she was feeling a little awkward about using that money. So we decided it should be a separate warrant article.
I think
it's good. So this is Montague, and they want to, they're going to be an intervener. And but they also want gas in the town. They want.
They want additional gas.
They already are a customer. That's why they have the right to
gas.
Yeah. He's asking if they want. I don't know. If they want gas or not.
It gives them.
I assume they were intervening because of the moratorium. They want to know
because of Berkshire Gas's moratorium.
Saying they can't get any more. Right. Gas. So they're trying to prove that they should be able to get it without a pipeline. But I'm putting words in your mouth. Yeah. I think they're opposed to the pipeline.
Yes.
But they want more.
I think what it is, they're trying to get the information. The only way they can get the information is by being an intervener. They're one of the few towns that qualify as an intervener because they are gas customers.
And they're big gas companies, I assume, for the paper mills.
Yeah. And they believe that the moratorium is basically corporate bullying.
Right.
They're not letting people have any more until people give in and say, yeah, build a pipeline. And Maura Healey's study, or the one she commissioned, said that we don't really need it. There are others that say we don't, others that say we do, but this is just to clear the air and to show that the moratorium is not a justified moratorium, basically.
Berkshire Gas makes money selling gas.
Yeah.
Why would they not sell more gas if they could?
They are, as I mentioned before, they are owned by a very, very large international gas and oil corporation, Iberdrola, out of Spain. And they've got caboodles of money, they've got plenty of gas and oil flowing, and they can afford to have a moratorium, and it's not hurting Berkshire Gas. And the guy...
I guess you have to subscribe to the conspiracy theory. My son always gives me crap when I talk about conspiracy theory.
Well, yeah. I
would just like to know the truth from
me personally. Yeah, and that's what
is the moratorium real?
Yeah,
but you know, even if they're run by a company that's in Spain, they've got to be a separate profit center, and they got to stand on their own 2 feet.
Exactly.
I don't know why, if they had gas, they wouldn't sell more gas.
It's UIL Holdings in Connecticut.
Right.
And it's owned by Iberdrola.
I do know that in the dead of the winter, when their gas consumption is out of sight in the pipeline that they have now, they have to import natural gas by truck into Whaley.
That's right. Exactly.
Which is a huge dangerous situation. Right. All the natural gas going over the roads.
That is the worst thing.
That's right.
They have to.
And
they
I
have
think
to
that's
that.
What they're trying to obsolete is cut down some of these loads they got to haul on over the road by enlarging the pipeline. I think that's my theory there.
It's a lot worse than my son did.
They got a whole liquefied natural gas, which is very dangerous stuff.
They're doing a lot of that. My son sent me some articles up because he lives near the Vermont, New Hampshire border. He said there's trucks going all the time up to New Hampshire. The factories that are out in the woods and are running on natural gas.
Route 2 corridor. Yeah. Up at the Corrine, natural gas trucks go to the Irving plant, paper plant's Irving. Truckload after truckload goes on there.
Somebody was saying the other day that they want to put a gas-fired power plant right next to the Vernon nuclear plant. That the town Vernon is asking for a gas-fired plant. nuclear and gas together, it should be pretty exciting, you know?
Jesus.
I don't know. I'll leave it to the citizen, I guess, to like comment here.
Yeah.
All right.
We're bringing it forward to the people.
So we have a warrant article on this.
Right.
Okay. And you're going to explain.
No, I'm hoping I don't have to. But I probably will end up with it.
So we're going to pay for Montague to be an intervener so they can get more gas.
Or so they can get to the truth.
So they can pay for the intervening.
I don't know whether they're looking for more gas or less gas. I don't think they're looking for more.
They are looking. I think primarily they're looking to get the truth about the moratorium.
Do we know what the total cost of their project to intervene is?
They don't know for sure yet.
I think they,
they've spent $15,000 already.
I think they appropriated $25,000, and I saw in the paper that some town is going to give them $15,000.
And
they
have
two fives already. And I've been talking to Ron Coulter, Kohler, is it? Up in
Asheville. Talking to you.
And he's trying to get an article, I think, for five. I don't know the exact amount.
Yeah.
So it sounds like they're going to be in the $40,000-$50,000 range.
And how does this benefit us?
Generally.
I guess we get to the truth.
The truth?
Are you going to ask Jim? He'll tell you.
But the point, I think, is to discover the truth, for one thing, and to discover that there is not that kind of need that Berkshire Gas is. They'll find out exactly how much gas Berkshire Gas is planning to buy off this pipeline, and believe that it will show that it is not one of those necessities that FERC will base all of this on, if it's for the common good.
I don't want to speak for my own view. I would think that they're hoping to show that there's enough capacity in the existing pipe to handle any growth they might have without putting in the pipeline.
Yeah,
I think that's really part of what they're doing.
If the townspeople approve that, can we attach that $5,000 to the sum of money we got already appropriated sitting there unspent on the pipeline?
Well,
the town would have to change the.
We would like to keep that money because we still haven't intervened yet. We still have to go.
You aren't going to intervene, you said. You only have granted one.
This is a different intervention.
This is the Berkshire Gas precedence agreement, I guess, basically. There's a whole bunch of them. There's a DPU one for access to property that's happening the end of this month, which. Mm-hmm. Where they, and it's just in tonight's paper. This one is about DPU and Berkshire Gas. Berkshire Gas needs to get a contract approved by our state DPU to take that to FERC, or Kinder Morgan does, to say, look, you need this pipeline because there's a precedence agreement between Berkshire Gas and the Mass DPU saying that they need it. They need more gas to satisfy their customers.
Mm-hmm.
If they don't get that, then they have less of their capacity sold, and it makes the pipeline more risky.
That's right, yeah. They have to sell 80% of the gas going through that pipeline before they can build a pipeline.
Now, the guy from Mass Conservation Commission said they've gone as low as 50%. Some pipelines, not this one, but others have been as low as 50%. And they've still been approved. Yeah.
And I just read an article that they're beginning to consider giving them permission, all that excess they can export. And there are like three pipelines going into the coast. Now there's a 42-inch pipeline along the coast that's also going up to the coast. And nobody needs that much gas. As far as I can tell. So.
Now, apparently FERC did give them permission to change the direction of the line of Buchanan. I understand they've been granted permission.
So yeah.
That's my son in the conspiracy. I said, told him a year ago that, you know, they're going to export. Oh, no, Dad, you're just supporting the conspiracy theory. And when it came out, I said, well, what are you saying now? Because it was a great paper that they allowed them to change the direction.
Yeah.
So it's quite obvious
and
now.
They're working on giving them permission, brink of giving them permission, to take that 60% extra gas or more and ship it overseas to a bigger market, higher price market. And the vice president said at one of our early meetings that we have to respond to the market demand, which is saying, you know, if we can sell it to Europe for more money, we'll sell it to Europe without saying that.
Yeah, but there will be contracts in place along that line. Berkshire Gas is one of them, and you know there are other users of gas that have you know, contracted for that.
Apparently the plant that I was talking about in Vernon is asking to tie into the new pipe.
Sure. Because they got a lateral going up there, don't they?
Are they asking for the lateral? I'm not sure how that. That they want to use the pipeline to put up.
So are they going to give us laterals to our houses so we can siphon off some of that? It's not going to do us much good.
No.
But I can, from looking at the territory they're going through, I can see the negative impact that it's going to have on us.
I guess you all are probably aware that the Article 97 is going to be challenged in
court.
The State Park there.
They're ready to take it to the Supreme Court if they have to. Apparently.
Okay.
There was one rejected on the West Coast.
Was there?
Yeah, which is a plus.
They
it's the first time they ever.
They rejected the compressing station. Liquefaction.
Because of the location?
They said there was not enough market. They said that the Asian market was
not
gone.
Enough.
And so why would you need to compress gas if there's no customers on shore? So.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm done.
So we'll see.
You're done on this topic. Now you have wastewater committee.
Oh, I do. That's pretty simple. We are trying to pull together the final report, and we would like to do an informational meeting, hopefully 10 minutes at town meeting. We're not asking for any money. We just want to get a read from the town, present the thing, see if they, you know, they can either dismiss us with thanks.
So you want 10 minutes for bylaws. Now you want 10 minutes for wastewater, too?
Well, bylaws can go a lot faster. I don't have to explain them. They don't want it.
You're going to get shot, Joe. You know that, Joe.
So I'll wear my best. Borrow best from Kenny.
The way I've arranged the warrant is to have, of course, the money articles first, going from highest to lowest, and then, other things after that. This didn't have anything attached to it, so it got stuck at the end, but I'm thinking that it's probably better if more people hear it rather than others. So I would actually move this up a little bit.
Sure, you don't want to move it up to the absolute end?
Well, it is at the absolute end right now.
Which one is?
The wastewater. You know,
we probably shouldn't even bother doing it then if it's the last one. Probably everybody would be tired.
Well, you see, that's what I'm saying. And maybe we should.
We are going to have an informational meeting. We're actually going to send an invitation to everybody in the center town and invite them to.
I recommend you to take it off the that ballot then.
Well, we got to get it. Got to get it in front of people sometime. If it gets tabled, it gets tabled. Committee's getting tired. Well, they'd like to get a decision from the town as to whether this is even worth talking about. You know?
Strictly speaking, it should come under Article 1, because that's to hear the reports.
Right.
Except those reports are actually what we put in the town report for fiscal year 15.
Yeah.
So, I mean, maybe it wouldn't, but...
Let's just leave it where it is, and Joe will handle it.
Leave it to us.
Yeah.
It's not money.
Let's not go crazy.
If half the people hear it, it's probably the best we can hope for. Hopefully at least half the
people.
Okay, so we already went over the other money and non-money articles,
I'm all set, I think, right?
Yes, and I appreciate you're not using the iron gavel on me. On that.
Thank you, Joe.
Thanks a lot.
You're extending the town meeting with all your articles.
I'm sorry. That's the way it has to be. Yeah. All right. Good night, gentlemen.
Thank you, Joe.
And Tom, you want to talk about the human resources study job descriptions and classifications?
Well, again, at some point I would like the job descriptions approved so I can get them out to people, and they'll all have the same form. That's my real goal there, is that we have everything's consistent.
Mm-hmm.
That's much more defensible if we run into a problem somewhere.
Okay.
So that's my goal there. And then for the classification, there is a space in each job description for which, and that's this piece. Again, it's just 1 through 6, nothing particularly complex about it, just increasing amounts of responsibility and experience. And so I was hoping that the select board could approve at least that part of it. And then, you know, over the next year, we can have conversations with the personnel committee and finance committee and whoever wants to be in it on the compensation
questions.
Well, how
has everybody looked at job descriptions?
Yep.
I have. I spent 3.5 hours this afternoon on my computer. We had every one of them. Okay. I had the only question I wanted, Tom answered for me today.
Okay.
And otherwise, you look pretty good.
Yeah, I think so too. You like him as well?
Yeah.
Okay, and this classification is, you know, this is standard stuff.
Well, is this going to tie it to?
Eventually, it will tie it to salary ranges, salary mm-hmm. wage.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, everybody has read these. These are, I think this is good to have.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion that we approve the job descriptions and the classifications as outlined in the job descriptions that Tom gave us and this document. Do you have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Painting donated. Proposal to donate to the 250th anniversary committee for auction.
We have a photo op. Put it back here so I
You've already seen it, of course. That is nice. Is that something in town?
David Tebow's place.
Oh, right, right.
Okay.
That's
this
great.
This was, and I told him about it. Donated for historical society or library or a fundraiser. And I think someone had the idea last time that this could be used for the 250th. I would certainly want a minimum price set on that. And our local art expert here thought that something like $500 would be,
I think, of 500 for that.
So this is for either 250th, the Historical Society, or the library?
It not even as specific as that, a fundraiser, or the Historical Society, or the library. Of course, the library isn't really a town library, but it would be available for anyone in town to see.
Would it be better at the Historical Society or the library rather than a fundraiser?
That is an excellent question, and that is up to the select board to decide.
This is a piece of Conway history. Do we want it with the Historical Society?
Well, Dave said that's probably Bill Gokey leading horses up there. Bill raises horses.
All right.
That house up there, that whole parcel of land years ago used to be a summer camp for kids coming in on New York State in the summer.
Oh, okay. Well,
that's way before, long before the present people bought it.
So this could be one of those three.
Yeah.
Okay.
So maybe you don't want to make that decision right now.
Maybe we want to think about it because this is a great painting, and maybe it's better with the Historical Society or the library.
Do we have an estimated value of this at this point?
No.
No, I'm just getting. I said if it was my painting, I would want at least $500 for it, mm-hmm. at least. You know, you frame a painting like that, just to get somebody to frame it's going to cost you $100-$150.
At least.
You know, that's at least. Incredible.
Time spent putting that together, too. Mm-hmm. It's amazing.
Yeah. It's a very nice frame. It's a very nice painting. You know, I was standing in front of the barn talking to Dave last week and told him about this painting, and he said, oh, my wife would be all over that. So I'm thinking at some point they may come down and take a look at it.
Well, I'm only disappointed that the town office was not one of the items that was
and it's awfully good up on the wall. Had you seen it up there?
I did. I had put it in the vault temporarily.
Well, one thought was if it was auctioned off, it would be used the money to offset the 250th expenses, right?
That was the thought last week. Yes. Yeah.
But I think it's more valuable than to have it auctioned off for the 250th. Let's think about it for a week.
Okay.
Okay.
Sure.
Let's think about it.
Sounds good.
Yeah. Well, you have more than
that's a great. That's a great painting. It's a piece of Conway history.
How about for people who want to view it? It would be available for viewing at the town office.
Sure. I think that's
you want
good.
To get the town office in that those alternatives, huh?
Yeah.
And maybe we should suggest making offerings on it. Maybe we might be surprised.
Well, Faith.
I know Faith is probably quite interested in it.
Well, Dave said she would probably very.
All right, thank you, Tom. Progress report on Department of Revenue recommendations.
I just wanted to bring up a bit of ancient history. That's this piece here. Back in 2012, the Department of Revenue finished their report on a review of town systems, as it says, overall management and financial practices and things for the financial offices themselves. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted to let you all know that we, the staff, have not been slouching on this stuff. I know Jan did a tremendous amount of work before I got here, when I got here, and afterwards, and Rick Dean, of course, was very strong on moving all of these projects forward. So I just wanted to document where we were on all of these things.
Great. Okay.
And
quite a few done.
There are five of these that are going to be covered under the Community Compact Plan and the Long Range Financial Planning that we're going to do in the fall with Joe Markarian. A couple of them we have considered and rejected for various reasons. The quarterly billing for taxes we didn't want to go to, and the Technology Advisory Committee wasn't as helpful as we thought it was going to be. Number 13, consider ways to streamline transfer of data. That's a technical question between the financial offices, and we're having a meeting next week to do that. Mm-hmm. The audit bylaw I have as one of the items in here. That's to allow the select board to make a contract of up to 5 years.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And the let's see. Oh yes, and that leaves. Establish the classification and compensation plan. That gets it done now. Well, not compensation. It gets partially done.
We established
the job descriptions and the classification. Now we're going to. So that's halfway done, and it is in progress. So that leaves really expand and codify the financial teams. Conduct a full review of the bylaws. And you'll notice that everyone, I do little tweaks here and there to try to make it a little bit more orderly.
Yep.
I may propose for these things that that Joe is proposing, putting numbers down on them and numbering the sections that they're in. It becomes easier to refer to them that way, and easier to add and subtract and change. So little tweaks like that. It really will take a committee at some point to review all of the bylaws, or at least review all the ones that we know of now. It's another task, and one that would be pleasurable, I'm sure, for some people to go back in the select board minutes. We have changes since, I believe, the 70s. Mm-hmm. Before the 70s, we don't really have a list of town bylaws, and there may be some interesting historical artifacts in there for some.
Sure.
That would be sort of separate from the main plan of codifying what we do have, what some of our practices are. There are some practices we have that should be in the bylaws that aren't. Yeah. For instance, some of the way the elections are run. So that is something that is remaining that I do hope to get to work on.
Okay, great. Yeah, great job on this, Tom. Looking good.
Thank you.
Looking really good. All right, next item is new business. The recommendation has been made to dedicate the town report to Rick Bean. And I think everybody would agree that that's a good thing to do for this year.
Was that the only recommendation for you?
That was.
And how do you spell that name?
Rick Bean.
B-E-A-N.
Just like it sounds, though. Mm-hmm.
All right, next item is anything anticipated, not anticipated within 48 hours? Huh?
No.
Okay, and your update? You have another update?
Did
you give us all of the updates?
I have nothing written. I've been working on these agenda items.
Okay. Concerns of the selectmen? No concerns. mail. What do we have in mail?
Well, I got one question. Okay. Can you enlighten us a little more on this email we've seen about the service on the tennis court?
I haven't gotten Weston and Sampson. I forwarded to Weston and Sampson, declining to sign off on the final project because of that. They were saying, well, this is one of the things on the punch list, and it is done. And I said, actually, we don't agree that it was done. I then got more information from Craig Warner, which was very helpful, that I then forwarded to Weston and Sampson. Now, they're in charge of the contractor, Mass West. They forwarded the information to Mass West. Mm-hmm. I have not heard anything from Mass West since then. And either they'll contact me or they'll work through Weston and Sampson. At this point, I prefer that they work through Weston and Sampson. But,
Okay.
Mm. Well, Weston and Sampson is the one that's supposed to be exactly overseeing it.
He'll hate overseeing it.
That's right.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes.
All right. Thank you, Tom. All right. Next item is mail. We have a flyer from FERCOG about our meeting, our joint meeting on the 29th. That's next Tuesday,
yep,
with the Ashfield selectmen at the town hall to talk about the fluvial erosion hazard assessment and river corridor management plan for the South River watershed. Okay, so that's next Tuesday. Everybody has that.
6:30, right?
6:30.
That's 6:30 to 8:30. Also, we have a letter from MBI concerning the governor's pause on last mile broadband. Hopefully, that'll get cleared up very shortly.
There was an article, I think, in today's paper, might have been in Saturday's paper, though, that the indications are that MBI has reviewed the work to be done in partial cable towns and does agree that it's financially responsible and financially sustainable. So
sure.
The last that I've heard, but it wasn't directly from MBI, was that they are prepared to move forward with Conway and the other partial cable towns.
Okay, good. Okay, next item. Our next meeting will be Monday, March 28th at 7 p.m. here in the town offices.
This is town hall.
Yeah, I know, it's town office.
It will be with the Finance Committee, and Dana will be there from Capital Improvement Planning Committee, so...
We'll make it town hall.
We should.
I'm thinking
town.
The larger space.
Okay.
Usual time, right? 7
Usual time.
It may be a late meeting, though, because, again, the goal will be to finalize the warrant.
Yeah, we'll have to get it totally finalized next week.
And then I'll have the following week, I'll have it for you to sign.
Okay.
We're not interjecting any other business other than that next week, are we? Did you know? So we can spend pretty much the whole evening on
There will be other items. That Peggy is going to come to talk about the Woodlands project.
Right.
I will see what I don't think it's going to be more than half an hour.
Yeah.
All the things that I have on there so far.
Yeah.
But then again, I thought that for the last meeting.
Yeah, so we don't want to get too inundated too much, and we don't have time to get the hills.
I'll confer with John about the possibility of starting at 6:30 if we need to.
Yeah. Okay. All right. If there's nothing else to come before the board, I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dominic. Thank you, Ben.
Yeah, my girl.
Missed my update on the warrant. Jeez.
What?